Welcome to the Startup Grind.
All right, guys. Welcome to Startup Grind in Bratislava. I cannot remember which number this is.
22nd.
22nd? Wow, we've been doing this for a while now. For 3 years now, we've been...
22nd in a
row. Still in the top 100.
Okay.
22nd Startup Grind here in Bratislava. We are now in the university, this is the Technical University of, it's very Slovak.
Mathematics and Physics and Informatics.
Mathematics, Physics and Informatics. Before we start, I would like to give a shout out and thanks to our sponsors, Telecom and Decent, who are making this event possible today. You should check them both out. Decent is actually a big blockchain company that is one of the number one startups now in Slovakia. Definitely go and have a look at them. They are hopefully going to change the world if all things go well. So it's exciting and we're looking forward to following them as things continue. But today we have a very special guest with us today. Michael Turban, if I'm pronouncing that correctly.
Okay.
Close enough.
Truban.
How do you pronounce that in Slovak?
Truban.
Truban. Truban, okay. Michael Truban.
Truban.
Yeah.
Michal.
Oh wow, that's getting very funny. Michal Truban. Today, and yeah, let's jump right into it. Guys, a round of applause for him for coming out here today and being here for us. So. Thank you for that.
I'll move these.
Okay. I'll just start singing again. So I think we'll kick this off. So you are right now well known in the ecosystem primarily for your company web support, and you started that close to 15 years ago now.
Yeah, you're right.
And it's obviously made quite a big of an impact here in the Slovak ecosystem. I would say you're probably one of the top success stories of startups that you have there, and a role model to future entrepreneurs. But I would like to start earlier than that and talk a bit about where you grew up and what happened before you founded the web
support.
Web support back in the day. You started web support when you were
18 and 19 years old.
Cool.
In high school.
Which is awesome. Quite young for an entrepreneur. And this was back in 2002?
Yeah, we established a company in 2002.
Exciting.
On the license of my mom.
That's what I call bootstrapping. That's awesome. So let's start at the very beginning then. And tell us a bit where you come from in Slovakia. Are you from Bratislava or somewhere maybe more obscure?
Yes, I'm more obscure than Bratislava. I come from north of Slovakia, the Kisuce, from small village Kisucki Leskovac, around 2,500 inhabitants, or citizens, inhabitants.
So you probably know everybody.
No. So it's a pretty huge village based on Slovak standards. And I studied in Žilina, my elementary school in Leskovac, and high school in Žilina. And it was, I don't know the English equivalent, geodesia, Premyslovka. So it wasn't a gymnasium. And I was really into computers, into IT, into gaming, then into some kind of lame hacking, into developing website and all the stuff.
What kind of games did you start up with?
My favorite game is, still is, my favorite game is FIFA, but back then it was Fallout, the RPG game Fallout. Yeah.
Oh, that's a while ago.
Yeah. I was able to left my trip into the mountains, where we were staying just to play for a few hours, that Fallout, and then went back. And playing games, it brings me to the computers. I wanted to know how to develop these games and how it works. And then I learned something. I learned how to code.
Okay. When did you start dabbling in coding?
My first touch with internet was in my first year in high school. So I was 15 years old.
Still had a dial-up modem.
Yeah.
The Bugs Bunny cartoon song that came on whenever you started, right? Good times.
Yeah, that was it. So my first website was something about the UFO. our teacher in our class, informatic class, he just showed us internet for the first time. We could Google anything. After a few minutes, we were starting to go porn, of course, you know, 15, 16.
The world that you're in this, and you know, it's only going to go one place.
Yeah, that was it. I fell in love with internet because, from my point of view, it brings you freedom. Mm-hmm. You can be in one place, and in few seconds, you can be in another place, and you can talk to people. I remember really strongly our first time when we connected computers with my friend in my small village, and when we sent it first. When we sent first our first ping between computers, and it worked, and we were really happy that we were able to send just some text. Yeah, for me it was awesome, and I think that this was what brings me to business.
Okay.
To become entrepreneur, and also
before you go in, so your first contact with internet was at what age? You said
15. Yeah, 14, 15.
And that's when you pinged the computer for the first time?
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah. You know, that's like, yeah.
Really?
Late bloomer.
And it was actually 1998.
Okay. So before we go jump into kind of your university days there, tell us a bit about your parents.
Yeah. My parents, they were also entrepreneurs, the small
cool.
entrepreneurs.
Okay.
I think that
they're early inspiration.
Yeah, I totally have some influence from them. So, my mom, she had small shop, was some kind of grocery.
Okay.
And my father, he worked as a engineer, and he tried to start a company with his other friend, but that friend really established that company just by himself. So my father, he still had a really, really bad experience with co-working with other people.
Oh.
But he started his new company 5 years ago.
Okay.
And I'm really proud of him that he was able to. My mom, she was so angry. She was like, why are you doing this? You are so old, like he's 60, and you are still, you have to rest. But he was really passionate about that, and he started his company, and now his company have around 8 or 10 people, and they were doing that, I don't know the English equivalent of that, some stuff with iron or something like that.
Okay, then he's
nothing,
the
nothing
like
that. Yeah.
So, what was he doing when his partner stole his idea or ran away with the company?
Yeah, because after that he was employed in other companies as an engineer or manager.
How did that impact you at that age, or when you kind of started thinking about entrepreneurship in your late teens? Were you afraid of, or did it leave you with any paranoia or anything when
no.
it came to work with other people? Mm-hmm. You managed to look past it?
Yeah. It wasn't a big trauma in our family, but they just wanted me to be safe. You know, when one journalist asked my mom what she was thinking about me starting a company, she replied him that I was thinking that he's going to jail.
They
were so supporting. And actually, my parents, they were my first investors. I realized that afterwards. But I asked them for first money for our first server, and my mother, she sold that grocery store, and from the grocery store they had around, I don't know, 50,000 Slovak crowns back then, which is, I don't know, around 1,500 of euros right now. And that money they invested in me, actually, in that our server. So, and I still didn't pay them back.
So you're really like a legacy entrepreneur here in the ecosystem. That's amazing. So you started the you started WebSport when you were in high school at the end there.
Mm-hmm.
And then you transitioned into university.
Yeah.
And you took WebSport with you.
Yeah.
How was that? First of all, maybe what do you study when you went to university?
I studied here in Ferry. It's in Electronic and Informatics University, not faculty. It's actually a technical university. And for me, it was my business or my entrepreneurship always brings me freedom. So for me, it was freedom because my parents only support me for the first year, and after first year, they fired me actually from the university, or I was fired, or I fired myself. My mother told me that she's not gonna pay me anything more, but happily or lucky, I already had some money from my company, so I was able to pay for my living here in Bratislava and for other years of study.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
And you started with sport alone?
No, I started with one guy, and he was with me for 1 year, and after 1 year, he left that company. Back then we haven't any money, so he left, and another guy can come with me, work with me, and he's still at the company.
Hey, did he come in as a late founder? Or?
Yeah, after 1 year. Actually, we met in a pub, and I asked him if he wants to join, because I knew him before that, and I knew that he's very, very good, one of the best IT guys.
Okay.
In the community.
So let's talk a bit about that relationship, because your background, you're also an IT guy.
Mm-hmm.
So you had two IT guys come together to build a
company. I'm an IT guy for 20% and IT guy, 80% like management guy. And he's IT guy for 1,000% and 0% social interactions.
He's also one that likes his personal space.
Yeah,
the wide berth there.
He's like prototype of geek.
Really early stage.
So I was able to start some like coding our first website, but I definitely needed a more technical co-founder.
Okay.
That was the reason we get together.
And how has that relationship developed over the years?
We were, of course, we had some hard times, but we were lucky that he's so antisocial that he didn't want to do like anything with people, anything with management. Right now he's in the company as a normal employee, as an IT guy. He tried to push himself to be like CTO, but after 2 weeks he said to me he's not going to do this anymore. Now he's one of the co-founder and also owners of the company, and he had his own boss, like his CTO.
Yeah.
So he's that easygoing guy, really easygoing guy, going guy.
That's an incredible story. That's not one you hear every day. So talk a bit about how that transition happened, because you guys grew quite fast once you got to university. When did you take on your first employees?
Actually, we grew really fast after we hired first employee, and we hired first employee after 7 or 8 years of company.
Was that far?
Yeah.
So it was just a two-man team for the first 7 or 8 years?
Yeah, we were...
How did that growth work during that time?
You mean when we were two?
Yeah.
It was, for us back then, it was only our personal project. We didn't have any like big vision that we want a huge company or really good company. We just want some money for beer or to party and to have rent here in dormitories.
Nice motivation.
Yeah, of course. And that was it. And after, when we were finishing our university studies, we were of course thinking about what to do with our future, and this was one of the possibilities. I was thinking about, should I go to find another job, to go to some corporation, and we realized that we want to continue with our company, and that was it. We hired first employee, and after the growth was in half year we had seven new guys or new employees, and after another half year we had another seven new people.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
So how did you balance your studies and being an entrepreneur during your university time? Because that's not everybody is able to do that. You see a lot of
I was able to do that too. I studied at university for 7 years. So.
Fair enough.
And I was fired 2 times actually. I studied. I was 3 times in our first year.
Okay.
So
you're really taking your time.
Yeah.
just enjoying the situation.
Yeah, that's true.
Cool. Because I mean, a common story you hear is very successful entrepreneurs who, once they go full into their startup or project, a lot of them drop out of university and then go in. But you completed.
I was thinking about it too.
Okay.
But you probably know the system, like education system, university studies. Here in Slovakia, it's not very hard. And when I realized how system worked, I was able to get my credits and to pass through exams.
Did you hack university?
What?
Did you hack university?
Yeah. That's right. Word.
Nice. That's a good learning experience.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's start then from the moment you ended and you decided to invest your time and your life into web support, and you saw that incredible growth. How were you able to generate revenue for growing? Because I believe you took on some investment during that time.
Actually not. We bootstrapped it.
Okay.
One of the main impacts to our company was when we went full-time. We started really learning about management, about entrepreneurship, about startups, about everything. I started attending conferences and all stuff, because when we hired first employee, I didn't know anything about management, about how to hire people. I bought a book and I read about how to do interviews, actually. I read my to-do list on the paper, and during the interview I was checking my to-do list, how to do a proper interview. And that was how we hired our few new people whom we didn't know. Because our first two or three employees, they were actually friends of us.
Okay, we've got some questions here we can jump into. Oh, that's an interesting one for the first question then. I wonder if I want to wait for that one there, because that's definitely going to lead into a longer discussion.
Mm-hmm.
But the second question, I think, is relevant. I know you touched upon that, but is there any part of web support that you coded?
No. I don't think so.
But you were coding in the initial year.
Mm-hmm. But only like website. And
only the basic.
We had 7 new websites from that.
So there's none of your code left over in the...
I don't think so.
Would you consider yourself a coder today?
No.
You would just consider yourself a manager?
Yeah. I wanted to start coding again like 2 or 3 years ago, and it took me 2 or 3 hours just to download all the stuff, and after I just realized I don't want to do this anymore. So
leave the coders to the coders.
But one thing I compensate the writing of the book,
yeah,
was for me was some kind of compensation for real work, like, because back then I was missing like real products and to real create things, because when you are a manager you only talk to people and you actually don't do anything real, and I was missing this kind of to create art or to create code, and for me the text is some kind of code. So it really helps me to be more satisfied with my work, just to work on something by myself, not to only give orders to other people.
So let's talk a bit about that, your management style. Because mm-hmm. you touched on being a manager is about talking to people. So if your management style is, how would you define a normal workday for you? When you were CEO at FirstWork?
I think the structure of my day was and still is pretty obvious. It's nothing special, you just came to the work and you have few meetings with your employees or with your partners, and that's it. And between the meetings, you reply to emails. And I still don't have time for big projects, like to sit on your computer and create something big and to do, I don't know, some kind of analysis or something like that. So for me it was always meetings and always talk to people, sell the vision, give them the feedback,
okay,
and this kind of stuff.
When did it transition into that? Because in the beginning you were first with two of you, then you hired 7 more people, and then it kind of snowballed from there. At what point did you go from being kind of an active, say, creative component or active worker in the company to being more of a management role?
Mm-hmm. I think that from 7-10 people, you have to. It's a size of company when you spend mostly all of your time with meetings, probably.
Just motivating and getting people to.
And
kind of
also brainstorm with them and all. To be you actually, your word became your tool. So you use your word, your thoughts to create things, but through other people. So that was almost all my time I spent.
Wow. And at what point did you step down as CEO?
I stepped down 2 years ago.
And how big was the company then?
50 people.
Okay.
So I stepped down because I realized that on the white paper I'm still CEO, but not anymore in practical way, because I co-founded a few other startups. I also started to do a triathlon. I realized that I am in my company maybe 4 hours a day, and the worst thing was that I am away with my thoughts, that I was thinking about sports, about other companies, not about web support. And people also in web support, they felt it.
Okay.
So then I realized that I have to find somebody who is fully focused on one company, like fully focused CEO. And I was lucky to find one. And he's there for 2 years, and he's really good.
Because that process is something I know a lot of entrepreneurs struggle with. Because
mm-hmm.
you build a company, it's your baby, for lack of a better word.
Yeah.
You've nurtured it, you've grown it, you've seen it mature. How do you deal with the realization that you're no longer the one with the toolset best suited for running the company? How is that? That must be quite an emotional experience, realizing that.
It comes slowly to me.
Okay.
So that's one thing that I get used to, that it's I'm not really into that company anymore. Just to be honest to myself, that's the one thing I realized and from that point it was actually easy. And one thing really helped me, 5 or 7 years ago I attended one seminar. I don't know how I got there, but I attended seminar how to pass your company to other people, and there were like 50, 60 years old guys who back then had much bigger companies. And for me back then it was like to have a big company, it was a dream for me. And I saw that guys and I seen them that they are beaten by their companies. They don't have any more, like freedom anymore. What entrepreneurship and business for me, it's about the freedom. And they was beaten and they weren't able to pass the company to somebody else. And there was a whole workshop about how to do that. And back then I realized, okay, I don't want to end up like this, to have a company and to be so attached to that company that from my child became my biggest enemy.
That's an incredible story.
It really helped me to decide, when I became honest to me, it really helped me to decide to progress that through that way. I always remember that workshop, okay, you don't want to end up like this, you have to pass this company to me.
You should do workshops like that here.
Yeah.
That's a pretty valuable lesson to be passing on to your mentor. You see a lot of companies, larger ones as well, that kind of they stay, they go stale, or they even fail because kind of the founding team is unable to let go of their baby.
Yeah.
But you said you started several other companies in the meantime there. Talk a bit about your side projects.
Yeah, maybe this is also things which help me to get rid of web support. Because I realized, okay, I have another company, so it doesn't matter anymore that I have a child, I have a lot of children, so...
You can choose which one's your favorite.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
And I was used to find a CEO to be the board member of the company or investor of the company, so it helped me to get this role also in web support.
Yeah. And during this time, you also, I believe, dabbled in angel investments.
Oh, yeah.
And how's your experience with that been? Have you invested purely in the Slovak ecosystem, or have you gone abroad as well?
Mostly, I invested mostly in companies which I helped co-founded in some way.
Okay.
Just
similar to kind of your parents' support for you in the early stages.
Yeah.
That love money.
Yeah. they were mostly web support spin-offs. So from some ideas from web support. And I also invested in a few other companies. But right now the companies which survive are only that from the web support, actually. So
let's talk a bit about that, because that's actually an amazing tool to be able to equip a company with. You are not only just the owner, or well, you were the CEO during the time. You encouraged your own people inside web support to develop their own ideas, and then you could potentially come in and help them create a company out of it.
Yeah. That was part.
How do you nurture that?
I think that was part of our culture, because we started web support not because of love to web hosting or something. We started with just, I don't know, it was accident. So we end up in the web hosting area.
You didn't have a burning passion for on your server.
I have never been the guy who registered all type of domains, you know, and deal with the domains, all that stuff. I just want to do some kind of business, the IT business, and we end up really accidentally in this kind of business. So during the time I realized, okay, I liked other businesses too, and I wanted to experience other people. I'm not so detailed person, so it's, I think also the triathlon, it tells it about me. You know, the triathlon is composed from three sports, I guess. So I'm not like deep into running, for example, but I like running.
Like stay broad.
And I like to see the thing which connects all that sports, and it's the same with the business. I love to observe and to watch other companies and to see their differences and also what they have common.
Okay, so can you maybe give some examples of that, of learning experiences where you've observed and then been able to take out the...
From triathlon?
For example, like, we see a lot of comparisons between sports and running a business. So what would you say, or maybe for you it was the other way around, you were first an entrepreneur in a startup and you used that skill set to equip yourself for a triathlon. How did you handle that transition, or how did that transition work?
Mm-hmm. One thing which really helped me was that I knew that I need to educate myself that way, how I educated myself in business. I have to educate also myself in the sport. So I read everything about triathlon, I watched, I went into the meetings, into the community of sportsmen, the pretty similar what I had done in the business area.
Yeah,
that's one example. There are plenty of others.
That's amazing. Yeah, I am not familiar with the triathlon example. I'm not an enthusiastic triathlon runner.
Okay.
But it's fun that the ecosystem is so similar, because obviously I'm very active in the startup ecosystem here, and that the triathlon one is quite the same. It's quite amazing.
It's sport and business, and sport and life, actually, and life and business and sport, they have plenty of things in common. It's, for me, the sport is a model of life. So I can see and I can taste the life, and I test the life in the sport.
Okay.
So, for example, during the marathon or during long bike rides or during some kind of trainings, you can experience things you can experience in your life.
When did you get into sports then?
I started to really training maybe 4 or 5 years ago.
Okay. So, and before then, were you an active sportsman, or?
I was playing football here in the university, and soccer, actually, football.
For our American viewers.
Yeah, for American viewers.
Okay, that's it. So, I saw a good question up here. So, this one I like. Do you think a teenager can start his or own business if he or she doesn't have parents who are business people? Interesting.
How question.
It depends on the support, I guess, you have access
to. You own the book. Who asked that?
We should buy his book, like, it's the right way.
Who asked that question?
No, but it's interesting, because it depends, I guess, how you grew up, what resources are available to you in terms of advice and people. I'd say anybody could probably start a business, whether you can do it well is a combination of luck and assets.
I think that you can start it, but it's pretty hard because your parents, they definitely have really strong influence on you, definitely, and it would be much, much harder to become successful when your parents don't help you. And when your parents are bad examples, yeah, for the people, I have great parents. For me, they were always, or still they are, happily, luckily, they are still my
role models.
Yeah, and you can do it exact opposite. You want even if you had bad parents, you can still became successful, but it's much, much harder.
That's true. They act as a very strong supportive branch of your life there.
Yep.
I think the question is maybe also targeted for students at university.
Mm-hmm.
And that's maybe a, I mean, we're in Slovakia, we can maybe touch on that a bit. Student entrepreneurship, and how do we get young people to understand that being entrepreneurs is an opportunity and is a possibility if, like you said, they don't come from families as fortunate as yours,
mm-hmm.
where both their parents can give them advice and help them establishing their first business. How, where can they find the resources here in the local ecosystem to be able to do that? What advice would you give them just to get started?
To start a business in university is the best idea. You have plenty of time, you have plenty of money, not because you have a lot of money, but you have really low cost, and at least...
Not a lot of expenses.
Yeah, not a lot of expenses, so I think that starting a business in university is the best time. But where to find resources? I don't know, it's a pretty general question. You can go to website, you can go online, you can attend a lot of seminars, a lot of meetings like this, so there is plenty of opportunities. You just need to go to this kind of stuff. You know, there's a really good startup community. If you want to start your business, just go there.
So
actually it's not so hard, but we don't have this in our culture to be really entrepreneurial, like to be a role model for us.
Okay.
And this is something what we need to change.
How do you see that developing? Because I mean, you started off as an entrepreneur in 2002,
mm-hmm.
And that's 15 years ago. How would you say the Slovak startup ecosystem has changed? So I'm guessing I've only been here 3 years, and even I have noticed a fair amount of change in that short time. You've really been riding the whole wave. What would you say are some of the big changes that have come into the system?
For me, it's very hard to say because I am like 3 years out of the startup ecosystem right now. But I was at the beginning of that. Even back then, like 6-7 years ago, it grew really fast.
Yeah.
It started in pubs where 20-30 people were drinking beer and talking about business ideas and. We brought some other older entrepreneurs into the community to share some ideas, and then we brought some investors and all the stuff. It started, then we went to Silicon Valley, but I don't know how it is right now. I didn't even know this company. It's famous, or they raised a lot of money, so I don't want to talk about this anymore because I really don't know any other startups right now.
What was your reason for leaving the startup ecosystem, or kind of the community?
Yeah, I left to US, that's one reason, and I became more interested in politics.
Okay.
Let's say it that way.
Your life transition kind of happened at that stage. What fueled that change? What was the driving factor? Because going from, like you called, entrepreneurship is freedom, politics is the opposite. So how would you define that change?
I hope I can still keep at least small amount of freedom. But you're right. And what I don't know. Even in Web Support, we didn't focus our company just to make profit.
Okay.
We used to do a lot of non-profit things. I think that Web Support isn't the biggest company in Slovakia. Isn't even like the first few hundreds biggest companies, but Web Support always have an impact on our in our community, in the startup ecosystem, and also I'd say in the whole entrepreneurial system in Slovakia. So I don't know, we were always like this, and this for me this is really a normal way how to continue my personal development.
That's quite interesting.
And it's also, I always like challenges, and for me it's like a huge challenge to do like a new thing.
Okay, but again, what was the driving factor that got you into politics? Because people don't wake up one day and say, you know, today I don't want to be an entrepreneur anymore, I want to engage in politics and deal with 5 million people in Slovakia. So how did that transition come about? Something must have irked you.
Yeah, it was a few things. One of them biggest impacts were when we founded Slovensko Digital. I'm not sure that if you're
familiar.
We founded that, and I realized that it's actually a small nonprofit startup. Right now there are 7, but back then there were 4, and they were able to stop project for 400 million euros, and they were able to really bring new ideas to government. And I realized that even if they are so successful, like 90% of their time they are fighting with the system. So I realized how to hack the system, like how I hacked my university. So I realized that we have to go directly to the power to have that to have that power to change it in the right way. That was one of the main like impacts or parameters which helped me to decide to go into the politics.
And what are you hoping to achieve?
I hope that we can bring new culture in politics. For when I started business or started web support back then, the word podnikatel or entrepreneur in Slovakia, it was attached to mafia guys. No. So
I hope that's not the case anymore.
I don't know. Every time they showed in TV, like one entrepreneur was killed, and I was like, "Oh, what the fuck? What happened?" And then I saw the scene, the black BMW and 10 huge guys around. You know, and that kind of entrepreneur. Okay, that's okay. that's not okay. But, I grew up in the atmosphere when you want to be successful, you have to be hard, you have to be good hustler, you have to be hard on other people, and we choose another way. We choose way of like freedom, happy company culture, and we became successful also in that way. And I think that politics are pretty dirty, but I think that we can upgrade even this kind of dirty business to something better.
Yeah. And kind of apply the skill set you learned as an entrepreneur to
that's one point of view. And I think that Slovakia and our country, the only thing which holds this country back, it's ourselves, like our politicians, we as a people. There is nothing artificial we couldn't change. And that was another thing that my ambition is to really unleash this country and really, really help this country to
hack the potential.
Yeah.
Nice. So let's jump in, take another. I like that one from Peter.
Good job.
You were not the first mover in the industry when you started. How did you overrun the existing competition? Jumping in the back to web support now.
Yeah, it was pretty easy. I have one chapter in my book about that, and the chapter is pretty short. And I. it's easy and it's hard. It's easy to understand it, and it's hard to do it. And actually, it's not my idea. I read one blog post from Seth Godin, how to beat your competition. Says only 3 words: faster, better, more. You have to be faster than your competition. You have to have a faster ordering process or delivery process. You have to be better actually in every aspect, in marketing, in everything, and more you have to give more value to your customers. And it's that easy. It's not anything artificial, but you just have to have better execution than your company.
Who were your main competitors before you guys kind of broke through into the primary market?
They were like local web hosting companies, even when we started our company, they were there for a few years on the market.
Okay.
So, and when we, after my university studies, when we became with this vision to create the biggest web hosting company in Slovakia, we were at the 11th place.
So impressive.
Yep.
I want to talk a bit more about your private life.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You're married now.
Yep.
When did you meet your wife?
11 years ago here in pub, actually.
In a pub?
Yeah.
Good place to meet.
Yeah.
How did she impact your life as an entrepreneur? Because you see a lot of entrepreneurs tend to be eternally single, because it's work first and then everything else. But you've managed to balance it, and she came in before Westport even took off, I guess.
Yep.
So, how did you balance kind of her and Westport and manage to take it further?
She had and still have a huge impact on me. She's a scientist, and back then she was working and studying in the university pretty hard. And she was also able to party pretty hard. So for me, she was inspired because back then I thought, okay, you are not able to study hard and also party hard. She was my inspiration. You can do this. She finished two universities, one in medical school and one here on Prirodovedská
Natural
science. Natural science. Yeah.
And she's a neurologist now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, that was one kind of. She was, yeah, and she's still really like huge. And I wanted to break with her based on this idea because when we really started growing, I was the type of guy that I was like, okay, she's holding me back because now I have to came from work back to her. And I don't have time for relationship and all the stuff, but I wasn't able to break.
She said no.
Yeah.
She was like, not today.
After that, it was a short period, after that period I realized that she brings me more energy and more support than if I was alone.
That's quite incredible. And
I realized that even when I was writing that book, I had periods where I was very down, like nobody's going to read this is shit. And she was really helping, and she told me that it's great, it's gonna be great. Just keep working. It's really good, and this kind of support and. I think that it's pretty hard to work and to achieve success or to achieve anything if you don't have support from your friends or from your family. Because back then I thought that I'm super great, everything is because of me. And after that I realized that I was not able to do anything just by me. Even in the triathlon, which is pretty like one person sport, when you think carefully about that, it's not one. You are not able to train for Ironman if you don't have, like, for example, your training partner,
yeah,
or good coaches or your family, when they are supporting you a lot of hours on the bike or on the run, and you have to have support when you came back, you have to have your dinner and all that stuff.
That's very incredible. And so kind of in the early years, I'm guessing her education was quite long. So during kind of the peak of web support, I'm guessing she was still studying. And then working in the later years.
Mm-hmm.
And now when you've stepped down, from my understanding, you followed her to the States.
Mm-hmm. Yep, now she's working really hard.
So kind of the career focus shifted, mm-hmm, during that point. That's an incredible balance to be able to cater to.
Yep. A lot of people, they are not able to understand how I was keen or able to move to US, but it hit me in the good period of my life. It wasn't a really hard decision for me just because I wanted vacation anyway, you know, so it was fun. Okay, it fits everything, so yeah.
Nice.
But now I'm bored in on the beach all the time.
You decided to go into politics.
Yeah,
nothing else to do.
Yeah. I think that also the concept of retirement, it's I don't think so, it's like really good, because after 3 months of beach, of, I don't know, vacation, actually, me personally, I got bored.
I don't
want to
do
anything, so.
You surfing a lot?
Grilling a lot, surfing a lot.
Your wife working, having a good time. Let's take another one here. I think we already answered the top question. I believe the answer to that was very, very much yes. Something like that one. Were you fired from uni because of grades, attitude, or something like that? Or just too much partying?
I beat professor. No. Because of my grades. Actually, I don't know, when we had the exam, I didn't know about that we had the exam. I just, because I wasn't focused on university. I was partying all the time and playing, not working, playing games and talking to people. I talked to people, so that was the main reason.
Having too much fun?
For me, the university, it was first time I came into the university. I already knew how to code and all the stuff, and I was really disappointed how the first few weeks went. I was like, okay, because I was really looking forward to become the student, like to, this is, wow, this is the university, this is gonna be great.
Peak and, academics,
yeah,
all of that.
Yeah, from the books and movies. Yeah.
the hipster professor.
And I came here and they were, it was pretty lame, and other subjects which I didn't like were pretty hard. So, and I had company, so I told myself that, okay, I don't need university, I can take care of myself. So that was the combination of all the stuff.
But wouldn't you say university is, it's about two parts of education? So one is the academic learning process, but I'm guessing also the other part is the social process and then things you learn. So you could say, yes, you were partying, but wouldn't you say that partying and being in that kind of social environment also probably left you with something, it taught you something?
Yes, of course. For example, our first employee was the guy who I met here, actually at the first night of first party.
First party, okay. Yeah.
First party.
How you hire people, guys.
And after that, I don't know, 5-6 years, I hired him, and he became one of my best friends. So yeah, it gave me too, and you learn a lot during parties.
Well, it's good and bad. Yeah, it's all about growth, I guess. Okay. And I'm going to cover that one in a little bit. How does Hadassah Nurmi, so that's what someone I want to talk about a bit of what you're doing now and what the future holds. well, the last one there, I think, since in the interest of his career, we're not going to answer it. though I guess I'm sure you guys are going to ask about legalization at some point.
In future, they are going to ask me, so I am prepared for the question.
We won't disclose it today. It's okay. We can do that. After.
Thank you.
Yeah, I got you. But so let's talk a bit about, because I want to touch on all of these questions. Let's talk now a little deeper into what you're doing now and kind of the reason you're back in Slovakia and kind of what the future holds. So as we already talked about, your interest in politics has now taken over, and this is now where you are heading. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a bit about more specifics in what you're hoping to achieve through this? Because you're still, I would say, quite young for going heavy into politics.
We just started a new party. Two or three weeks ago, we gave the signatures to Minister of Interior to establish our party. They should do this in few days.
And who are you establishing?
That's good question. I'm not only one co-founder. For me, the Progressive na Slovensko, that's the name of that party. It's strong because the team behind the party is really strong.
So it's Progressive Slovak.
Yeah, Progressive Slovak.
For our American viewers.
Yeah. And they, when I told about a new party in America, they asked me what's the name of the party, and I told them it's Progressive Slovak. And they're all
going to take your comments.
Because I live in Florida. So. What was the question? Oh, okay. the team behind the Progressive Party. There are a few well-known names in communities, not world, like whole Slovak known names, but in their particular communities, they are really well-known for their achievements.
Okay.
There are businessmen like me, there are people who know about politics, people who worked in other non-profits organizations, and they are really credible and really like good people with not so huge egos, and it really helps in terms of teamwork. So for me, this is the baseline of success, to have a really good team.
I completely agree. And this is kind of, I think, where the primary learnings from entrepreneurship channels into politics and one of the parallels there.
Yeah.
Because you are building a team here to establish a political party, and I'm guessing not everybody, even within your own party, is going to have the same political agenda, per se, or the same vision in terms of where you are on the, I guess, traditional political spectrum.
Actually, we are named Progressive Party, so all people in the party know where we are.
Okay.
Like, this is another thing that the values of the members for establishing members of that party, they are pretty aligned. So those are the good things for me.
Okay. And I don't want to talk too much about Slovak details in terms of the party, because that's not what this is about. But I want to talk a bit about how you want to impact entrepreneurship in the future. If you want to impact entrepreneurship, there are, I guess, let's say two primary areas. It's about incentives for new businesses and education. These two are probably the most impactful. You're more of an expert in this line, so be correct.
You're right. I think that the discussion about entrepreneurship or businesses in Slovakia is narrowed only to bureaucracy, how to get rid of bureaucracy, how to get rid of or how to lower taxes. But I think so. I think that the biggest impact on entrepreneurs, or what holds us back, is our education. Again, it's ourselves. It's as in a company. The reason why I don't have a company with thousands of employees, it's only me, that I was not able to scale it that way. And another is that because of I was not able to hire so many good employees. So I think that the main focus how we can help Slovakia through entrepreneurship is focus on education, and specifically for how to bring more entrepreneurship spirit and entrepreneurship values into our educational system.
Okay. And so, what's your opinion on what the core entrepreneurship elements are in an educational setting, and then what age do you kind of need to start touching on that?
I think from elementary school you have to learn some basic soft skills. One of the, I think the morals, how to do business, and the soft skills are very underrated in Slovakia education system. For example, like presentations. First time when I was presenting something, it was in university.
Really?
Really. Like my first presentation was maybe not even in the first year of university, maybe in the second or third.
That must have been terrifying.
Yeah, for me it was like, we had the some kind of project, and we had to like present the project, what we have done. First time in university, I was like, whoa. And I think that you have to do this in elementary school also. And another thing for me was that kind of management skills. So in schools, they gave you homeworks. In university, they gave you homeworks or projects. And they didn't teach you anything about project management or, for example,
or study skills or anything like this.
Yeah, so for me it was always like, okay, you have the project, then you started it one day before deadline, you know, and then we realized, oh, that project is really huge, so you're not able to do it in one day. So I think that this is, we lack a really like basic management skills. And also in Slovakia we are really low in financial education, so almost no one knows about about a lot of
like financial products and stuff. And this is a common problem.
Yeah, that's true. And I think that also we should think about education through whole life and also entrepreneurship education, because why our companies are so small. One reason is market, of course, but another reason is that lack of business or entrepreneurial education in your whole life. So we should, the people or I am thinking it's just concept about some kind of MBA, but not, you know, that kind of program, but really for only like 1 year, and everyone can attend it.
Okay.
Like from whole population, even like 50 years old guy who wants to know about how to start a business and how he should be able to get some kind of formal education for this.
What about creativity? So creativity is obviously a very very core aspect of entrepreneurship and innovation. How is the Slovak education system today fostering? Because in general we say you're born, when you're a child you have maximum creative capacity. Mm-hmm. And this generally dissipates over time, usually the longer you're in school, or the longer, older you get when you start school, and then later you go into work because of repetition and monotonous work and kind of lack of time and capacity to explore your own ideas without having to consider consequences. Mm-hmm. I guess that sounds pretty bad in some mm-hmm. aspects, but take it in a good way.
It's worse.
So if you are so creative at an early stage of your life, how do you think the education system could then assist with fostering and keeping students creative up until the point where they can turn that creativity into innovation?
In education, everything is based on the how great teachers you have. So, like, average teacher, they are not able to teach you really to be a creative. And so I think the main focus should be to bring much, much better teachers and better wages for teachers to attract more and better people to want to become teachers. So this for me this is, again, as a company, if you want to do great thing as a company, you have to have great employees. And this is same in the educational system. You wouldn't have a good educational system just based on that you will figure out some kind of processes and programs. There's always the people behind that. So you have to focus on bringing and to teach teacher at first, and they will teach good things and also the creativity, all the things to young.
Yeah.
And the problem, for example, with online courses, is the statistics behind online courses are that only 11% of people finish them. So that's not the future, when people thought that, okay, now we have all that e-learnings and all the stuff, we can distribute the educational system and scale that really, really, really high. It's not working that way.
But you this links back to what you said earlier as well, with who are your role models, mm-hmm. how do you access them? Kind of, like I said, not everybody's going to be as fortunate as you and come from a household of role models. Mm-hmm. Some of them need to find it, and I guess most people should get that at school.
Yeah, that's true.
So, I want to do one last question now before we...
I'm not sure if I'm able to stand after this.
Yeah, it's going to be rough. I don't know what bomba supa is. Is that like fuck up?
No,
I don't know.
Bomb
soup.
I don't use it.
Maybe the first one there is where you were getting your ideas, inspiration for all your projects. So they're all pretty different. That's true. And what they have in common? I guess you come back to that.
Yeah. I try to go out. That's the main thing, that you have to go out of your out of your comfort zone, because your surroundings your surroundings have the biggest impact on you.
Yeah.
So when you want to become creative, you have to do a mutation between things. So that's the reason I like to do different kind of sports, because you can get inspired by writing one thing. For example, in swimming, there are some kind of exercises, and you can incorporate it into the other sport, for example. And it also stimulates your brain when you try new movements, and it's also the same when you try new type of, I don't know, knowledge or courses or technologies or something like that. So I try to be active, and it helps you to bring inspirations. And all the time I'm thinking about when we do something in our company, for example, when we solve any problem for us, I always think, okay, is this problem bigger? Can this solution solve also the problems for others? And then we just speed up based on that.
That's cool.
Just to be open-minded and try things and play with things, because all of time people hold themselves by themselves no, you just need to try things pretty lean, pretty cheap, and then you can see if that's the right direction or not.
Nice. So would you leave the audience here with any last advice before we wrap up?
Don't drink and don't smoke.
And non-political answer.
Different kind of politician. I don't know, just thanks that you come, thank you for having me. I think I already told a lot of wise words.
It's true, it's been a session of wisdom. Yeah.
So next time I will prepare something really, really smart.
Like a nice little catchphrase at the end.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for attending our Startup Grind today here. I'd like to give a last shout out to our sponsors, Telecom and Decent. And we are, of course, looking forward to seeing you next time. Thank you very much. And, of course, a big thank you to Pekka Prada, Mikael Truban. And give him a round of applause. Thank you very much.